Hi, everybody. It's Gene Simmons, and you're not, and you're listening to the Potter Than Hell podcast with Steve, BC, BB, and Dylan. But you knew that, didn't you?
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Potter Than Hell podcast. This is your last stop on the crazy train of hard rock and heavy metal. So sit back, buckle in, and hang on. Here we go.
Hello, Potter Than Hellions. Welcome back to the Potter Than Hell podcast. This is Steve, and I am joined this week by
BC
and
BB.
Keyboards tonight is
Dylan.
And we have a newbie here tonight. We're going to sacrifice another virgin tonight, BB.
Yes.
We have with us our good friend of the podcast, Mr. Joe Cassaro. How are you, my friend?
Awesome. Thanks for inviting.
Hey, thanks for coming down. And as you guys can see by the title, see that, Dylan? I didn't forget that after fucking 3 years. He's got his Kix shirt on tonight, so he's the only one.
How can they see that by the title?
Huh? Well, because it's going to say Kix in the title somewhere,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, but how would they know that he has a Kix shirt on by
well,
the
I'm
title?
Saying that he... Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Well, Joe has a Kix shirt on.
Maybe we'll put his picture
we can see
instead of our, instead of our design.
It's,
we'll have Joe's shirt.
It's just plain
yeah,
Kix.
Like,
okay.
It'll be like when what Prince we went by the symbol.
Get it while it's hot. Okay, you may hear that title as well later, maybe. All right, so Joe, welcome. Thank you for hanging with us tonight. Joe's been a good supporter of the podcast for a long time. Every time we have a live stream, he's always there asking for us to pick Kix songs all the time. So we figured I'd get Joe on and we'll talk a little Kix tonight. But before we do, once again, welcome, Joe. And condolences to Paul Stanley's guitar tech. Franz Stuber passed away this past week from COVID, and I guess he's been with Paul forever and ever, so they canceled the show that night that they were supposed to play the night after he passed away. Sad, totally, you know, sad, because he was a guy, and everyone's posting their pictures with this guy on, you know, the Kiss Cruise and at shows and everything like that. I had never met the gentleman, but everyone's saying he was a really nice guy, so, you know, condolences to the Kiss crew out there.
Yeah, he was the voice. You wanted the best.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, he's that's right. I'm glad he brought that up, Joy. He was the guy, all right, BC,
you wanted the best.
Yeah, so I wonder, I wonder who's going to do that now. Did they ask you, BC?
Not yet.
No, okay.
He didn't check his email, that's why.
Maybe you get on the Kiss Cruise
technology
for free, tell him you'll do it.
All right, cruisers, son of bitches.
Get ready. All right. It's been a while since we've had the four of us together here. It's been like probably a month, I think, since we all got together. BB had stuff going on. He was up in Boston watching the Red Sox have a good win. And a lot of other crap going on that we, you know, personal shit going on. But glad everybody's back. It's always cool having everybody back here. And so what's up, BB, with you since you've been gone? Since you've been gone.
Yeah. I'll give a quick rundown. My dad fell and broke his hip in the hospital a week, in the nursing home for a week. Now he's home doing a lot of PT, so I've been really kind of down there a lot. He's really sucking up a lot of my time now because, you know, he'll be 79 next month, and mom's 78, so she can't, you know, if she falls, she can't help him up or do anything. So I've been down there quite a bit, and it's taxing. It's taxing on everything. It's taxing on everybody. So we're getting through it slowly but surely. But, yeah, we're up in Boston. Saw the Red Sox win. You know, that was great. So, it's been a roller coaster couple of weeks.
How about you, BC? What's up with you?
Yeah, same old shit. Running around. Not enough time in the days and trying to get stuff done. And it seems like the list gets bigger and bigger.
How about you, Dylan? Anything?
Yeah, not too much. Excited to go see Dune tomorrow. That'll be a great time.
Yeah, we're gonna go see Dune tomorrow. Absolutely.
Yeah,
we're gonna sing "To Tame a Land" while we're walking out.
Yeah. Blast Maiden through the speakers as we're driving through.
Yep. All right, and Joe, how's things with you, buddy? Everything's cool?
Awesome. Working, playing.
All right.
Headed off to see Winger Friday.
Oh yeah,
nice.
Yeah. Where's that?
Penn's Peak.
Oh, they Penn's Peak.
Yeah.
When is it? Friday.
Friday, I think. Last in Line is opening for them.
Oh, great place to see a show.
Of course, I'm working. Shit.
Penn's Peak's a great venue.
Penn's Peak is an awesome venue. Awesome venue.
You could be back at the bar and it's
yeah.
Good. Yeah.
One of my favorite places to see a show.
Wolfgang Van Halen posted a thing, you know, where they're playing shows and stuff. And he's like, you know, where would you like to see us play? I'm like, fucking Penn's Peak would be, that'd be awesome to see.
Awesome
to see Mammoth there.
He just broke his leg, didn't he?
He like sprained it really bad. He wiped shit rolled off the bus, I guess. Fucking wiped out. So it was, he said he'll be in the boot for like 6 weeks. So, all right, cool. As far as it goes for me, everything's cool so far. You know, everything's all right. Work's been BC as BC and BB would know. Work's been busy, but that's nothing new. So, what are we listening to here, gentlemen? Oh, wait, before we do that, how about last week? Yeah, how about last week's episode? Now, who was you? Weren't there for that?
I was
right?
not there.
BB
right.
always seems to miss the pick lists.
I throw the shittiest list out there, and I never make it.
See, because he can't stand the public ridicule, the live ridicule that he gets it. So we had Sunny Halloween Pony on last week, and this was Dylan and Sunny's dream episode that they've been kind of wanting to do. So I. Like, all right, fuck it. Out of format, whatever the fuck you want to pick. What'd you think, Dylan?
It was a lot of fun. Like I said, I really loved most of the songs on that playlist. There wasn't really anything that I disliked except for the Fuck Shop by Two Life Crew.
What?
That was the only one that I really didn't like.
That was the best guitar work in it on any of them.
But the rest of the songs were great. Even the rest of BB's picks that he was trying to throw out as a joke picks. I enjoyed them still because I really like the 80s and all the music that comes from it. So it was a fun episode and always good to have Sunny on.
Yeah. And by the way, tonight's October 20th. The episode won't be out till the 22nd, so you'll have to wait till a Friday to hear it, Joe. What do you think, BC?
Oh, good time as always. It's great to have Sunny on and a little bit out of the wheelhouse there, but nothing that we weren't familiar with, I would have to say, because back in those days, you listened to radio a lot and these songs were forced down your throat whether you want it or not, and video. But fun episode. I mean, some funny songs.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. There was I did terrible pick guessing who picked
who
what.
Who won the picks?
It was me.
Dylan
won.
Oh
boy,
yeah.
Dylan.
Yeah.
I was on a roll. Like I picked like the first five in a row. I'm like, oh, that.
I started
and then I'm
terrible.
Like, oh shit, it's gonna
any
suck.
Of like the first 12, right? And was I was like, oh,
boom,
God.
Boom, boom, boom,
you just spoiled it for Joe, by the way.
Well,
Dylan.
No, it's okay.
But it was
you
fun.
You can see the Cinderella story, the come from behind
yes.
victory.
Yeah, don't call it a comeback, right?
Yeah, been here for years.
Yep.
That's in the 90s. That'll be on next year.
That's in the works. We got that going down a little bit down the road. I had a good time. And like BC said, and we talked about it on the episode, that like all these songs, these, you know, if you want to go out of format for our podcast songs, you saw these videos all the time when we were waiting for Judas Priest, Another Thing Coming, come on the radio, on the videos, or like Lick It Up or All Hell's Breaking Loose or stuff like you know all these songs, like and you can't separate the two. So some of them I didn't know. Like that Two Live Crew one did suck, BB, by the way. but it was fun.
They had the best guitar work in it. They were overdubbing Eddie Van Halen's Eruption on there.
But they like come up with your own shit. Jesus. And I thought that was like a later song.
I thought that was
too.
Funny. I thought that would be like my Steel Panther of 1980.
That's horrible. Don't insult Steel Panther like that.
I already picked the BC Boys. We had that quota filled.
That box was checked. All right. So what are we listening to, guys? Joe, how about you? What do you got? What do you listen to these days?
Well, today was all heavy stuff. Cutting the grass and everything was all heavy stuff.
The grass for the music.
No, no, it was all Corn and Disturbed and that genre, but mostly I'm listening to 80s hair. That's what I listen to every day. I throw the phone in the car, turn on Spotify, and I have my playlist downloaded, and it's all 80s hair. So, Kix, obviously, from Slaughter to Poison to all those bands that I couldn't get enough of back in the day.
Nice.
Awesome. And thankfully, most of them are still playing now, so you can still have a chance to go see these guys. How are you, BB?
I don't know if you picked this up, Righty, but one of the many vinyl websites that we go through had a Badlands demo, an unreleased 1988 to 1989 songs that were kind of raw, not finished, some demos that were not even mixed. There are 17 songs that are. So if you are a Badlands fan, definitely check this out. I'm sure you can find it on YouTube because Badlands they're not on any of the mainstream streaming things. So
you won't see them either.
Yeah, it's called Demos and Unreleased 1988-1989. There's like 17 songs on it. Good stuff. Great guitar work.
All right. Dylan, what do you got?
I have things on opposite ends of the spectrum. On one end, Ice Nine Kills finally released their new album, Welcome to Horrorwood 2, or Silver Scream 2, Welcome to Horrorwood. Fantastic album. Really great. Awesome songs. We're going to be talking about that album more in an upcoming episode, and I'm very excited about that. But on the other end of the spectrum, Dave Grohl released his autobiography, The Storyteller, and I've been listening to that on audio. He narrates it, so that's a big plus, and it's been really good so far. I've really enjoyed that as well. He has a really fun way of explaining things, and he told the story about him breaking his leg on stage and all that, so it was a really cool listen so far.
Did he mention that we were at that show at Citi Field?
Not yet, but we're kind of hopping around in the timeline, so we might get there towards the end.
Okay. How about you, BC? What do you got?
I got, since I was not home most of the week, I've been listening to, but music that was playing around me at the time, a lot of Tom Petty, Ozzy Osbourne, and Jacob Dylan. I think I got that right.
Yeah, Bob Dylan's son.
Yeah.
You must have been hanging with my brother-in-law.
Yes. Which totally sounds like, I thought it was Tom Petty.
Yeah.
He goes, oh, this is, Jacob Dylan. I'm like, ooh. Sitting here thinking it's Tom Petty. I'm like, oh,
getting schooled by the Dame.
Getting schooled by Damon.
Yeah, as soon as you say Tom Petty, you know it's my brother-in-law. All right, and for me, I checked out a bunch of stuff this week. Still checking out the KK's Priest, really good Sermons of the Sinner, Alchemy, The Lords of the Black, Alchemy of Souls Part 2, really good. Ronnie Romero vocals on that is fantastic. And the new Alcatraz album, Alcatraz 5, minus Graham Bonnet. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if it's Dookie White singing on that or it might be him, but really a ton of like Yngwie like solos on there, like not the crazy shit that would have been from like Trilogy or Marching Out that type of solos in the songs, and he the guy has the tone too. I think it's Joe Stump also that played on the last one. I think it's the same band except for Graham Bonnet. So that's what I got going. So here's what we got. Joe's got my two nemesis bands, Korn and Disturbed. That's well, cut your head off music, not cut the grass music.
Let me throw something in there. You know what kept coming up on Spotify this week? It's Jeff Scott Soto, stand-up live version. Stand Up and Shout from the movie, Rockstar.
Yeah, from Rockstar. Stand up and shout.
Oh, who's singing that? Oh, Jeff Scott Soto. Oh, yeah.
It's amazing live. It's absolutely amazing live.
Jeff Scott Soto's fantastic. Sonny Pony will absolutely fucking love you.
Did you guys get that album? The duets that he does? I just got it.
I saw it. I didn't get a chance to check it out. Yeah,
$20.
I didn't get to listen.
I saw it. I didn't get a chance to check it out. Yeah, he's good. Yeah.
Your boy Eric Martin is one of the songs.
Yeah. It's amazing. Yeah, the one song he does with Eric Martin is fantastic.
Yeah.
Actually, in last week was The Monsters on the Mountain in Tennessee me and BB had tickets for and couldn't go. Yep. But one set did not go to waste. Stephen Michael was able to get my set and give to someone that needed them. So that was good. He couldn't get both sets, but he got at least my set.
That's weird.
And was able to use those.
I could have probably contacted them somehow.
I tried contacting them. They never got back to me. Hmm. Our buddy poor Vince Neil fucking wiped out and fell off the fucking stage up there.
Boy. Yeah.
Broke a couple ribs. Ugh. I think that was the only glitch in the show, but they had a lot of good bands there. So a lot of bands that you're going to see on Monsters of Rock Cruise, Night Ranger, that I'll be seeing.
Did he do it on the first song so he didn't have to finish the set?
I think it was towards the end.
Oh, okay.
Well, that's got to be a good sign. I mean, that he broke ribs because, like,
there wasn't as much padding.
He was a bigger guy, so he's losing weight.
Okay.
Well, and also too, in speaking as a fat guy myself, I could say this that, like, when your ribs are wrapped, that's going to make you slimmer too. Everything's going to be tight. It's like wearing a girdle.
Yeah.
Fucking tighten you right up.
I think he was playing guitar when he fell.
Yeah, I think he. Yeah. Right, so he it was probably "Don't Go Away, Matt," because I think that's what he.
Just dive off the stage.
Don't go away. Fuck off the stage.
If landed on that guitar, that would have hurt. Yeah.
Ooh. We'll write off that guitar. Yeah, so I'm glad he didn't get seriously hurt, though. I mean, that it was like, boom, gone. Like, fuck.
Yeah, speedy recovery, Vince.
Yeah, because Steven texted me that night, holy fuck, Vince Neil fell off the fucking stage. I'm like, oh, shit. So that was cool, though. And actually, next week on Thursday, me and our KISS crew will be headed out to the KISS cruise. So we're going to record the night before, but then I'll be out for a week. So So the three blind mice are going to be doing an episode. Yeah. It's going to be some probably fucking acoustic bullshit. But when Steve's away, the acoustic will play.
That's right.
So
no, we're going to do another Scorpions episode without you.
Fucking kill you. I'll give you the gen. I will fucking kill you. All right, so Joe's got Corner Disturbed and some 80s hair stuff. Dylan's got the new Ice Nine Kills album, Hollywood Scream.
So it's the Silver Scream 2.
Silver Scream 2.
Welcome to Horrorwood.
Welcome to Horrorwood. Okay. BB's got the Badlands demo, and it was the 88-89 unreleased tracks. BC's got some Tom Petty, Jacob Dylan, and some Ozzy. Myself, a little Alcatraz, Lords of the Black, KK's Priest. So before we get into the show, here's something we were going to do a month ago that we literally we had it here that night, and then BB couldn't come, right?
That was, the, I think that, yeah.
So we held off.
We held off, and then.
So that, actually, that was the night that we had Dave Borowski here. So we gave Dave one of the beers.
Oh, right.
So we're going to do the taste test now.
That BC wasn't here.
Oh, BC was. Oh, you brought. No,
BC wasn't here, and then the next 3 weeks I wasn't here.
But you brought the beer, though.
Then it must have been the week before that I wasn't here.
Yeah, because BC it was all my fault.
Well, we dropped. He dropped the beer off at our house or something because I had to bring them, and then we didn't end up drinking them.
Oh, I don't know. Anyway, we're gonna do it now.
God damn it! 9 months later, we're doing it.
Ooh, the can's got a cool texture to it. It's
it's a wrapped. It's a wrapped can.
It's Iron Maiden, Brew Dog, Hellcat. Better beer, fiercely deadly, and independent.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So the thing on the side, we got six percent alcohol. Iron Maiden and Brewdog unite to launch Hellcat, a feisty India pale
like
lager
head with your beer?
Where hops and malt collide. Hellcat rages with a citrus forward flavor with a no less aggressive malty backbone. The result is a hazy gold IPL. With an especially, they spelled especially wrong. Oh, sorry, epically. They didn't spell especially wrong. I just can't read. Epically complex balance. Brewed in the USA, Hellcat joins the global trooper family of beers, crafted by Maiden vocalist and beer aficionado, Bruce Dickinson.
Bruce. Don't drink and fly, BC.
It's a cool cool logo.
The cover's really cool. It's like an Eddie Lion, right?
Yeah, it's
an American pale lager. It's brewed in Ohio.
Is that Robinson Brewery? No.
It's some American.
Yeah, American Brewery.
Canal, Winchester, Ohio.
So you can actually get it before it's out a year.
I literally ordered it. I don't think it was a week.
That's what happens when you go USA. All right. It smells a little fruity.
How's the bouquet?
The bouquet is a little fruity.
A little citrusy.
It does. It smells a little fruity.
Yeah, it's very. It, you know, it's citrusy. It smells more like an IPA citrus.
Yeah.
All right, boys, down the hatch. Here we go.
Oh, I did get that citrus whiff.
You need to smell it?
Yeah.
It's not bad. It's not one that I'm going to sit and drink all fucking night. There's worse Iron Maiden beers out there.
It's not bad.
They need to just come out with a hard cider. It's a very.
It could be like Fear the Dark hard cider, like the apples could be coming from the tree.
Yeah, it's a very. That's a very British drink, a hard cider. I'm surprised they haven't gone there, but
It's okay.
I'm not part of a multi-million-dollar band.
But I'm not a big craft beer guy, but it's not bad.
Not an IPA man?
I'm not an IPA man. No, I know BB likes that. He was going to buy that fucking Yingling Hershey syrup beer that they have.
Ugh. I mean, that's not bad. I could suffer through it as much as I could suffer through any
Yingling. Put anything that is milk in alcohol. It's just gross. So what's thumbs up or thumbs down, BC?
I drink it again.
You drink it again?
Oh, definitely.
You can finish mine then.
Right.
It's not bad. It's not bad. The cans are cool.
It's very foamy, though.
I want one of the cans.
It's very foamy.
I don't know why either, because it's literally been chilling for a month. No, well, it's these plastic. I blame the cups. It's the cups.
Oh, yeah. It's the cups' fault.
It is.
Cup is warm and beer is cold.
Beer is cold.
That's true. I should have put the cups in the refrigerator.
Yeah, come on. You didn't chill the plastic Dixie cups.
Frosted Dixie cups. Yeah.
We're fancy around here. Come on.
God damn it. Can't believe you didn't think that over.
I know. Sorry. I was just so excited that everybody was back together. I forgot all this shit. All right.
Stop.
Let's talk some kicks. They started like 1975, I believe, around there. And at times they were called the Shoes, S-H-O-O-Z-E, the Generators, and the Baltimore Cox. First album they put out, I'll just go through the discography really quick. Kix self-titled 1981, came out in September. Cool Kids, March 7th, 1983. Midnight Dynamite, October 7th, 1985. Blow My Fuse, September 19th, 1988. Hotwire, July 9th, 1991. They had a Kix Live album, came out in 93. Their final show, their final album with most of the original guys, 1995, Show Business. They came back out in 2012. They did a Live in Baltimore album, which is fantastic. They put a DVD with that on as well. Then 2014, they did the album Rock Your Face Off, which is really good. Like they were back. They had the same Kix sound, and that was like really. They didn't have Donnie Purnell writing with them, but you could have swore he was there. And they had Mark Schenker writing with them because he was the bass player with Steve Whiteman when he was Funny Money. They did Joe, did you see the documentary? They had a documentary Can't Stop the Show.
I did see it, yes.
And they put out a soundtrack for that in 2016. So we're going to do what we like to call a starter kit here. So like if someone had never heard Kix before, here's 10 songs that I think you should listen to that will get you into this band. So we're going to let Joe go first tonight since he's our new guy here. And so Joe, before we go, just give us, you know, how you got into Kix. Actually, if you want, give us, since it's your first time, give us how you got into this type of music, and then you can get into Kix and give us your Kix story.
Well, of course. You know, I have to go back to the 70s, and the band that really started it for me was with the rock band that started for me, and you're wearing the shirt, Steve, was Kiss.
There we go.
It was just Kiss. And then that progressed into, you know, Boston and then the bands, and then along came the hair bands. And by that time I was, you know, I was driving, had a car, I can go see concerts, I can go see shows, and that's what it became. And it just, that genre of music stuck with me ever since, is that 80s hair metal, you know, and you know, everybody knows what happened when the 90s came along, and I'm glad these guys wrote it out. I'm glad a lot of bands wrote it out. Yep. From the 80s. And you know, all of these bands, you know, Kix, Slaughter, Vixen especially, they're so fan-friendly. You know, you go to these shows, they appreciate that you're there. They put on a show, whether there's 100 people there or 10,000 people there, yep, they put on killer shows. So that's how I got started. That's why I love this music. For Kix, I remember I used to carpool to college. I got in my friend's car one day. He pops in Cool Kids cassette. He goes, "You got to listen to this band." And that was it. That was it for me. Done and over with. They were the band. But unfortunately, I never saw them live until later on. For as close as they were, well, what happened is 1992 got married, 1994 first kid came along. That was it for shows for a long time. You know, family came first. But I did attend a ton of Rush shows. Rush was my band back then too. So fortunately, you know, Kix wrote it out. You know, they went on hiatus for a while. Mm-hmm. You know, they all did their own thing. Ronnie did Blues Vultures. You know, Steve did Funny Money.
Brian did Rhino Bucket.
Brian did Rhino Bucket. You know, when we say Steve did Funny Money, Jimmy was also in Funny, yep, Money with, mm-hmm, Steve, and Mark as well, and Dean Kramer. I'm going to see Dean Kramer play Sunday. So, you know, these are, like I said, gratefully these guys wrote it out, and the fact is that they're super fan friendly. I've seen them dozens and dozens of times in the recent years. Became friends with all the guys. I've done Kix Camp down at the Maryland Institute of Music. I have to throw that in there.
Cool.
Maryland Institute of Music and the head vinyl record shop. I'll be there Sunday. That's a great place. And I did Kix Camp with them and actually played with the band. So wow. It was
that's awesome.
It was
that's
awesome.
Really cool.
Yep.
Yeah, I saw you were restringing your bass today, actually.
Yep. One of my basses got a restring. That's my 80s bass. That's the one that's the bass that's tuned for all the hair stuff. You know, Kix and Vixen and Kiss. It's just the way the bass is tuned. So, like I said, I love the band. Love the guys. They're super, super people. They really are.
Yeah, and I was we were talking about this before, and I told Joe, I said, like Joe and I have we have several friends that are acquaintance, you know what I mean? Like we have friends that cross, and we were playing cards at our one buddy's house the one night, and we were talking back and forth about it. And he's like, "I never seen Kix." I'm like, "Well, like I know you're a huge Kix fan." I'm like, "Holy shit, you haven't seen fucking Kix?"
That'd be a bunch of years ago.
That was yeah, a while ago. Yeah. That was over Jerry's dad's house.
Yeah.
And I was just like shocked that you didn't see Kix, and then like I'm glad you finally got to see them. And it's and it's kind of opposite for us. I mean, we saw them with everybody, right. And I'll get into that when it's my turn. But I just wanted to throw that in there that I'm you know, it's always cool when you get to see a band that you've never, you know, that you love, that for some reason over the years you never got to see. It was like that with me with Metallica and Ozzy. I didn't see Metallica until 2018, and I never seen Ozzy until 2019. And you know, I've been a fan of those bands since the early 80s, and and they've played around here a shitload of times, and it just kind of works out sometimes where you just can't get to see your favorite bands. You can see a ton of other bands, but you just don't get to see that band. But yeah. I'm glad you finally did, and it sounds like you made up for some lost time too.
I did, and I made a bunch of great friends through Kix as well.
It's amazing. Now, did you ever think, and we've talked about this on the show before, that you would make such good friends at this point in your life that you consider lifelong friends now?
Oh, absolutely.
You know, it's crazy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like all our podcast buddies and stuff like that. Like, you know, I never thought I'd be making new like good lifelong friends at this age of my life. You know, you figure you pretty much have your crew that you hang around with and a couple, you know, guys on the outside and shit that you know them, shoot the shit with, but like actual good friends. It's great, and it's all from the music.
Yeah, and there's a group of people, I call them my rock and roll family. We message each other on Messenger, and we'll say, what shows you going to, and we all just try to hook up at certain shows. And like I said, these people are lifelong friends.
That's fantastic. That is excellent. So what do you got for us? You can give us your list, you know, what you like about the songs, the whole nine yards.
Well, I wish I was a little more prepared with that.
No, it's okay.
But I'm going to go with, you know, my first song, obviously, is Blow My Fuse. You know, I love Blow My Fuse. It's the song that I played with Kix at the Kix camp. I can't say the copyrighted Kix Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp, but it was Kix camp, and that's the song I played with them. And I had a blast doing it, and I still play it all the time. It's just a great song to play. Going down the line, there's a Cold Shower, but I have to go back to that first time I heard Kix play. It was Cool Kids. Cool Kids did it for me, and I know, you know, it's not a Kix original song, and I know that how Steve Whiteman feels about that album, but that was the song. That was it. That was it for me.
All right, very cool. Yeah, and Blow My Fuse, we got to see them do that whole album down at M3 a couple years ago, and because
Fuse, it was that whole, you know, Fuse relit.
Yeah, yeah, they did the whole album, and that and to be honest with you, that was the first Kix show at M3 that we literally stayed for the whole show in a long time, because like we. And not to, you know, be mean or whatever, but like we were kind of kicked out for it because we seen a certain amount of burnout on them because we seen them so many times and like, you know, like but like M3, that's their home game. That's their home show. That's like their show. And the only time that they didn't headline, actually 2 years they didn't headline on Friday night. The first year was because they didn't have a Friday night. They played in the afternoon the first year. That's when BB texts me 2 o'clock in the afternoon. BB, BC's puking. I'm like, holy fuck, it's 2 o'clock in the fucking afternoon.
And it was like 95 degrees. BC's laying out in the grass. He's just like baking.
And then the only other year is another year where BC was puking.
The roofie year?
The night that Wasp opened. Wasp closed the night out. So Kix went and then Wasp went. So that was the only really good
look out for your friends and protect them from being roofied.
Yeah. So Joe, and it's always cool too how you always revert back to that first moment where you are like, holy shit, this band is fucking awesome. And, you know, I could do that with, you know, like name a band, I could probably tell you what song I heard the first from them, like a band that I'm really, you know, really like into. So and that Cool Kids album is really cool. I can't think. I'll get into the when I seen them. Actually, I'll get into that when I did about them playing live. So, all right. So, BB, what do you got for us?
All right. I was a little late on the Kix bus. I think it was, you know, of course, like 1989 with their big hit, Don't Close Your Eyes. And then I kind of had a backtrack to Midnight Dynamite and then forward to Hot Wire. So like those three albums were my go-to for Kix in this time frame that we're talking about, and it shows because a lot of the songs come for those three albums. My buddy's brother also had Midnight Dynamite on cassette, and we copied that, and we were playing that. So like between Blow My Fuse and Midnight Dynamite, they were the two big ones for me back in the late 80s, 88, 89. One of the songs I really like in their catalog is Hotwire from the album Hotwire. I think it's it's aggressive. It's heavy for Kix. It has a really heavy sound to them that you're not used to hearing. It still had that Kix melodic sound to it during the chorus. Brian plays a great guitar on this one. Really, really cool. Along with Steven screams when he's doing the vocals to the end of this song is really, really great. Another one I obviously enjoy is Cold Blood from Blow My Fuse. That's a perfect 80s hair metal guitar opening riff. It has great band harmonies. The drums are killer on this song. Another one I enjoy from their first album, their debut album, Kix, The Itch. That is iconic. Iconic Kix song. Always do it live. A great staple live when they do it. And it's always like a little step heavier and faster than the original version, which I really enjoyed listening to the live compared to this one. Another one from Blow My Fuse, Red Light, Green Light, TNT. Drums out front. Killer, killer drums on this. I love the back and forth guitar work and harmonies that Brian and Steve are doing on that song. Really, really cool. Another staple. Love the harmonica, you know, throughout their discography. Another one from Blow My Fuse, No Ring Around Rosie. More band harmonies. The harmonies from this band is amazing. It has a catchy chorus. Once again, the guitar solo is amazing. And they're and once again, we got more harmonica. So you can see where I'm getting these songs from. Little guitar, little harmonica. You know, you got the great combo, especially the outro solo with going back and forth with the guitar and harmonica, which is really, really cool. Another song off Hotwire, Girl Money. Great. It's such a toe tapper, heavy tune, very catchy. I love the stop and go in between the chorus and the verses. Another one from Midnight Dynamite, the title track, Midnight Dynamite. Great melodic sound to this song. The band harmonies, once again, are fantastic. The pre-chorus verse is really, really cool, the way they sell that. The dual guitar solo from Brian and Ronnie are great. Go back to the debut from Kix. How about Hey, Hey, Hey? This song, they're such a tight band, because I didn't even realize halfway through the song that it's recorded live. And then when Brian starts talking, I'm like, Steve. I mean, Steve starts talking, I'm like, and I'm looking at both of you. I'm like looking at Brian and Steve, Brian and Steve. And then like he starts talking, I'm like, holy shit, this song is live. And that gives you like a little insight of how Kix is live. Because he's talking about getting a cold case of Heineken. He's got a big bottle of Jack. The girl's throwing up all over the floor. It's just funny. You know, if you ever see them live, it's just hilarious the way he takes that section of that song and goes with it. And to close my list from Midnight Dynamite, Cold Shower. The cold lead vocals between Steven and Ronnie Parnell are really, really cool. It brings a real different sound to this. And the bass runs on this song are really, really cool. And once again, we got a little bit more dual guitar and harmonica parts. There's my list ready.
Good list, BB. You may hear a couple of those songs on, at least on maybe on my list, but a couple I don't have. No Ring Around Rosie, that like just missed my... I had 25 songs that I had it narrowed down to. And No Ring Around Rosie just made it around 13-ish. I love you got a little cowbell in that one too.
Yeah,
no
true.
Rosie. And I like the bad, bad girl. Fucking love that. I didn't put Yeah, Yeah, Yeah on there because I figured you or BC would have that on there. Great song. I remember seeing those guys live the first time. And he brought out and they were in the opening. They were an opening band. I'll talk about that when I talk about my list. But he brought out this big, huge, I don't know, it was like a net, and it had all these fucking balloons in there, and he rode it like a fucking cowboy, and the fucking balloons went everywhere, and that was like at the end of, yeah, real cool. And you may hear a couple of them ones on there, but cool. So I really like, there's a lot of songs that these guys have that there's that interplay between back and forth guitars, and then there's back and forth between the guitars and the harmonica. Yeah. Which is fantastic. And Steve Whiteman is just a kick-ass fucking front man. Still to this day. The guy weighs about, like, fucking 75 pounds, I think.
If that.
right, he's literally, like, the fucking stick figure that he draws when he does an autograph. He does a stick figure with a microphone. The microphone has more meat on it than fucking he does.
You're wondering how he stands up on stage because of, like, how thin those legs are.
I know.
And then he dances like...
I know. craziness. We got PC.
Kix.
No, about BB's list, not your list.
Stop jumping the gun.
Relax.
Jumping the gun. I'm caffeined up today, baby. good list. I mean... A little later, Kix.
Yeah.
And like you said, I mean, here's a band that I think is probably the first band when I first got that brought harmonica to their music. Now, later on, a lot of bands started doing it, but they were the first that I can remember using a harmonica a lot. And I thought that was kind of cool because it's a very un-rock and roll type instrument.
Vince Neil plays it.
I was like the opposite of Joe. When I got to Cool Kids, I'm like, because, you know, I had those three, and it's. Once you go back into a catalog and it's a totally different sound, you're like, it's all right. You know,
well, it's because they evolve. Instead of going,
when you're going backwards, you're like,
I mean, I will say there are some duds on the first two albums. There's a couple duds on there. I think they did Locomotion at the one show. And I was like, oh, God, what the fuck is this? Because it's Whiteman played the sax, I think, on that show.
That had to be definitely in the 80s.
Because I've
seen the sax. I know where it is today.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's cool.
It's at the Maryland Institute of Music.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. No.
It's in a glass case. Wall.
Rick Parks has it, and he isn't giving it up.
That's awesome. Oh, I'm sorry, BZ. Keep going.
No. I mean, overall, you're going to hear a few of his picks. Overall, good list.
Yeah. What'd you think of BB's list there, Joe?
Like I said, I wish I was more prepared for this. I loved it. I love every Kix song. So, his list is great. And you go back to Yeah. You know, the last couple shows I was at, Steve asked the crowd to pick the last song between Blow My Fuse and Yeah. It's been going Blow My Fuse. But you're right. You know, he's up. I think – I don't want to throw the word COVID in there. I don't want to use it. But, you know, since the COVID – they haven't been playing, so the balloons have gone away.
Right.
So I've seen them probably 5 times since the shows have been back on. The balloons are gone. Maybe they'll come back.
Right.
But anyway, it's funny, like you said, the guy, and I'm talking about Steve Whiteman, he keeps himself in tip-top shape. He keeps his voice in tip-top shape. I mean, how many 60-some-year-old singers from the 80s can still sing
still
like
sound
that.
Like that. Yep.
Exactly. I mean,
and he's a vocal coach too.
Yes.
That's crazy.
And he was Lizzie Hale's vocal coach.
Jeepers. You know what? I did hear that. He did say that on an interview. I forget who he was on there. I actually might have been with Steven maybe.
Yeah, so. he taught vocals out of a place in where Lizzie Hale was from, I think down in Penn Lyon, and Lizzie Hale was one of his students.
Lucky him.
That's cool.
You got anything, Dylan?
No, I recognize a lot of those songs. Definitely heard most of them live, and they translate really well live. They have such a good energy to them that I really enjoy. And I mean, there are two bands that I've definitely seen more than once, Alice Cooper being the band I've seen the most, but Kix is definitely up there just because of how many times I've been to M3. Kix has always played. They're the constant. So yep. It was a good starter list for sure because I recognize most of those songs. And I think they are really good, a good way to get somebody into the band, for sure.
All right. Very cool. All right, so there's Joe's, there's BB, so we're going to do our gem song. So I didn't even tell Dylan what it is this week, so I hope he can help you. I'm sure you can get it. this band, I've been seeing their Facebook page. It's an all-female band. For some reason, I just listened to this stuff. I never got a chance to just punch them up on my phone and check them out. But it was one of those days where... On my radio, my you know, my radio, my vehicle. I just go between Ozzy's Boneyard, Hair Nation, Octane, and
Old Nation.
No. What's the other one? The
Liquid Metal.
Liquid Metal. So I was, of course, it was like you get in the car and there's like fucking like some shitty ballad on fucking Hair Nation, and then you get fucking Danzig on fucking Boneyard. I'm like, oh god, so just fucking real quick shoot back the fucking Octane, and I saw that they came up. The band's name is Plush, and the song's name is Athena, not the Who's Athena, Dylan, but really, really good song. I don't know if any of you guys have checked it out.
I started writing it down, and I was trying to see how you spelt that. Yeah. I knew where you were going. Yeah. They just released one song. It's on Apple Music. Yeah,
the album comes out in a couple weeks, I think. But real, like, it wasn't. I don't. It was one of them things where I didn't know what I was expecting, but when I heard it, it wasn't that. But it was really good. So Dylan's gonna play it now. Athena by Plush.
We'll be right back.
All right, I hope you guys enjoyed Athena by Plush, and they right now are out on tour with Wolfgang Van Halen Mammoth, so if you could check them out. I know they're doing some shows in the South, at like the Atlanta area. I know they're doing some shows around Nashville, Memphis, and stuff like that. So if you see Wolfgang playing, they're playing a lot of dates with him. So I hope you guys like that. Their new album comes out on the 29th, which is the day we will be sailing the high seas for a Kiss cruise. So I will definitely have something to listen to on the way, on the plane ride back. So do a couple of hidden gems here. So we're going to go with Dylan first tonight.
Yeah, my hidden gem.
Another country heard from.
It's a band that I've talked about before, probably as a hidden gem, but this EP I did not talk about. The band Night Demon, they're very much kind of new wave of British heavy metal sounding, but they're a band that's like operating right now. They're newer. They came out with an EP called Vysteria, Vysteria, back last year, and it's a pretty fun 4-song EP. If you really like the, you know, early Maiden kind of feel, Saxon type of band, this is a really good band that's kind of picked up the torch from them and is continuing it on. So check out Night Demon with Vysteria.
All right. Those guys are friends. They were on the Talking Maiden a lot. And I think they have a podcast, too.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. What do you got, BB?
Well, let's go back to 1987. We kind of off air, we were talking about Freely's Comet. How Kix opened up for Freely's Comet around here back in the day. And I always enjoyed this song off of the Freely's Comet album because it's kind of shadowed between like the Rock Soldiers and the Breakout. You got to check out Calling to You. I think that's such a great song, greatly written. It came from a song that was called Megaforce in 1982 that one of the band members brought into the band.
Probably Todd.
Yeah. Yep. It was. Now that I'm reading it, but great song, great guitar work as always. But Freely's Comet, we're calling to you.
All right. Let's go with BC here. What do you got, BC? I know BC's is good.
I guess band Danger. I mean, back in the day, these guys were chugging along, and they recorded an album in 1993, Cockroach. I guess, let me see, volume one. It was recorded with Ted Poley shortly after they got done recording, before it was released. Something happened, Ted left the band, they got the new guy in, re-recorded the vocals. He did re-record it in 1994. So in 2001, they issued this as a 2-CD. CD 1, say Cockroach Volume 1 was Pauline, and Cockroach Volume 2 is Ted Poley. But I mean, I'm sorry, I'm a Ted Poley guy when it comes to Danger. He is just rock and roll. He's such, like Joe was talking about, guys being down to earth. He's very down to earth. He gives it his all, whether it's 20 people or 15,000, don't matter. And just when you play these albums back to back with each other, Ted Poley.
Team Poley.
TP.
I'm going to go next, and I'm going to let Joe bring up the back part because BC and I will be going next on our thing here. Band I was kind of scrolling through, like if you have Apple Music and you know if you listen to a band on something or actually I think this might have been Amazon. If you buy an album or a CD and then things will come up underneath it. People that bought this also bought this. And I was just kind of scrolling through. I couldn't even tell you what album I bought. And I saw this band called Toxic Rose, and I'm like, that's kind of a cool name. I never heard of them before. So the album's called In for the Kill. It came out this year. And I'm like, I'll check these guys out before I, you know, I want to sample them before I bought the CD. And fucking excellent. Really good. I was like, how? They have one other album out, came out in like 2016. So I don't know if they were on hiatus or they just, I have no idea. I couldn't even name a guy in the band. But the album is called, band is Toxic Rose, the album is In for the Kill, and it's really good. There's some really good, very, a little harder edge melodic rock. Like not, like la 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 shit, like just cool harmonies, like heavy stuff, but like not, you know, no Cookie Monster vocals or anything like that, but just really good, solid, hard rock. So Toxic Rose, In for the Kill. And Joe, what do you got?
All right, I know you guys are going to hate me for this, but I'm staying. I'm staying on the Kix theme. I'm going to. I had a first choice, but I'm staying on the Kix theme because I have to. I have to promote my band. Steve Whiteman, you're welcome. He put out his solo album. Do me like you done me before. You know, I got it. That's where I got to go. Sorry, boys, but I got to promote the guy. He's awesome. And during COVID, he got together with Jimmy Chalfant, Bob Perry, Dean Kramer, and Brad Divins and put out this kick-ass album. So the album's You're Welcome. The song is Do Me Like You Done Before.
All right, I have checked out that album. I enjoyed it. Yep. A lot of harmonica on that album. Yep. Real lot of harmonica on that album. I like it. All right, so there's our hidden gems. Joe's got Steve Whiteman song from the You're Welcome album, Do Me Like You Done Before, which is a really good song. Dylan's got Night Demon, the EP Visteria, which is very cool, too. I know that one. Ace Frehley, song Calling 2 from the first Frehley's Comet album from BB. Danger Squared, Cockroach number 2 from BC, the Ted Poley version, not the Paul Lane version. And for myself, it's Toxic Rose In For The Kill. So there's our gems. So next, we're going to go BC's list. BC's going to have a little wow factor tonight, I think.
Wow, wow.
Kix, Jesus. Going back in time here, I mean, my first exposure to Kix was Cool Kids. I forget, some friend had it. He was playing it. I was like, so of course I ran the next day and picked it up. Current playing this. And then 85, first time I saw Kix, opened up for Ace Frehley. A local venue not too far from here.
And by the way, that was March 5th, 1985.
1985, that's before Midnight Dynamite?
Right before Midnight Dynamite, yep.
So they came out, and I'm like, okay, here I'm hearing some of these songs that I've only listened to, like on the album shit. And I believe they played some.
I think they did. The set list wasn't on the internet, but
I remember.
I know they had to.
They played one or two that I didn't hear. Anyways, kick-ass show, I mean, but here's a band that's been around. They're Road Dogs, and this band has played with everybody and their brother, I believe, and I think we've seen them play with everybody and their brother. I don't know how to describe them in my book. There's nothing really fancy about Kix, but they're so damn good. They're just straightforward. It's like awesome plain pizza. There's nothing fancy about the pizza, but it's just awesome. That's how I... acquire Kix in my
pizza's kind of like sex, even when it's bad, it's still kind of good.
Yeah. This is really good plain pizza, no pepperoni, no nothing, just plain pepperoni. I have plain pizza, and it's damn good. So, if I was gonna have somebody check this band out for the first time that never heard of them before, which I'm sure there's not too many people out there, but maybe Restless Blood would be a song that would off their 83 album Cool Kids with it's just an upbeat rocker in a classic vein of Kick style. I mean, cool riff, no fills. Steve's vocals on the song are just cranking, as a nice little part before the solo. Solo is not a fun solo, not too, you know. Again, good pizza. The second song I would go off 1980, Blow My Fuse, Red Light, Green Light, TNT. BB picked this too. I mean, the drums, the riff in it, just a rocking, again, the Kix formula to me. It's just a straight ahead rocking song, even it, and harmonica, come on. You can't do it, you can't think of Kix without harmonica. Third song I would go play for them would be off 1991's Hotwire with Girl Money. And just another upbeat, you know, song, good vocals, good group chorus, and the bass line in this song to me stands out. I think this is probably the first time I ever listened to Kix with headphones.
Oh, yeah?
Believe it or not, yeah.
Wow.
Then I go back to a Cool Kids album with Cool Kids. I mean, this is probably the first song I've ever heard from Kix back in the day. And it just sticks with you. It has the bass and drums, straight ahead riff, has some cowbell, tambourine. It has a catchiness to it. And it always stuck with me throughout all the years. Fifth song would be off 1981's the self-titled one, The Itch. I mean, that's just so catchy. Guitar start with the drums, the build up to the chorus. Again, I got The Itch.
And in a bitch.
And in a bitch.
She's crushed it.
And then going back to the, of course, my first Kix album, the Cool Kids with Love Pollution. I just think this is one of my top five Kix songs. I don't know why.
Oh, yeah?
It always stuck in my head. Always, when it comes on, it's just, I love the opening riff from it. And then after it, it's like kind of like, not chugging, but just like a picking and a guitar. It stands out. The chorus with the background vocals, love it. Then I'm going to move up to 1985's Midnight Dynamite with Cold Shower. The vocals with the bass and the drums, I guess, then the group vocals, and then it kicks in with the heavier riff. It even has a little bit of a spoken word. Not really spoken, but it's not. He's not saying it, he's just kind of...
That middle part.
I guess there's no solo on the song, but I guess the drums and the bass are just make that song.
You get that bass break is fantastic.
Stick out, yes. Going back to Blow My Fuse with number 8, She Dropped Me the Bomb. Just an upbeat, driven riff, killer solo on this. Again, this is the classic Kix sound. Number 9, I'm going to have Cold Chills off of 1991's Hotwire. I mean, the bass and the hi-hat. And then just Steve's vocals in this, the chorus. And I believe it's like a little bit of woodblock. Another cool solo, but the whole song is the bass that makes this song. To me, it's just the bass is phenomenal. I'm going to stick with the Hotwire album for track 10, Same Jane. Just another classic song. If you're going to be into Kix, you're going to love these songs. It's more harmonica solo on this. I mean, you can't go wrong with Kix and a harmonica. And, oh, I'm at 10 already.
I have a bunch more. It's like it goes like that.
I have 17 here. I had a bunch more written down, too, in case.
Just in case.
Just in case I needed to pull some out of
that. Unless you need to call in Omaha.
Yes.
What do you think, Joe?
I think, you know, we're creating set lists here. That's what we're doing. You know, you just look at the band set lists, and they're never the same. You don't go to two shows and the set lists are ever the same, but we're creating set lists. And this all the songs Brian picked. Cold Chills is not one of my favorite songs.
Oh, come on.
I love it. Bass. It's just not one of my favorite songs. But, you know, it's like, and BB and Brian both said The Itch. What a great song live. The fan participation, everything. It's just a great song.
You got anything, Bill?
Yeah, The Itch is fantastic. That's probably one of my favorite Kix song.
And in a bitch?
It got the, I got it. It's really a real fun call and response that you know the band when you could just do that because sometimes people won't be in the know and they won't be able to just respond right away with I got it, but it's nice when everybody's when in on do. It.
Yeah, you go to an M3 show, everybody knows all that shit.
Yeah.
What do you think, BB?
Yeah, great list. We had four duplicates, four off of my list. So, you know, so we're in the same vein. You had like the three songs from the Cold Kids album. But Love Pollution, great song. She dropped Me the Bomb, another one from Blow My Fuse, which was a great pick, which just missed my list. But a very good list. I just wish I can get in the Cool Kids a little bit more, but just, you know, that's where you started. So, you know, you have that foundation, you know. You know what I mean? Even today, I listen to it, and I'm like,
takes me back.
It's missing a little for me, but very good list.
All right, coolest BC, Wrestles Blood. I think I picked that on one of our playlists that we did a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, I think so.
Fantastic song, I love it. Red Light, Green Light, TNT, another great song. Background vocals, great background vocals from these guys. Cool Kids, I remember seeing them do that live. It was fucking awesome. And they kind of did it. Even then, like with the back and forth, with the talking, hey, when they kind of talk back and forth in the song, they did it like that live. Love Pollution, that's shock. That's kind of a shocker for me for BC. Cool song though. Cold Shower, I'm gonna call an audible on mine, which I don't know why I even didn't think of this song in the beginning. Cold Shower is great. That bass part is cool. It's cool, and I like. That's when Mark gets up on that box and does the bass part. Love that. She dropped me the bomb. Another cool one. That was one just missed my list. Cold Chills. That reminds me of like a like an NXS song or something like it has that different feel. It's definitely has an un-Kix like feel to it. Maybe that's why Joe's not totally down with it.
It's
different for them. It's different. Same Jane. Actually, I rocked the hell out to the song today. I'm like, wow. I'm like, I hadn't. That was one of the songs I hadn't narrowed down to, but it was like way down. But then it came on. I was like blasting shit this afternoon. I'm like, that song fucking rocks. So, cool list. I like it. And Joe, I think you're right. I think we are creating set lists here. And we'll do my lists. And I'm going to say, it's weird for me because this band is like Tesla. The very first time I heard them was live. When they opened up for Quiet Riot at the West Side Theater. And that was August 24th, 1983. So Cool Kids was out. First album was out. And I remember it like it was yesterday. We were maybe 15 rows back. West Side Theater, fantastic theater to see a show. And they came on. You got the air raid siren. And the lights were going around the crowd like you see like in the movies and all that shit. And then da-da-da. And they come out with atomic bombs. Cool song. And listen to that song. I love when they do the da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da, da-da, just absolutely love that song. And it's not a song they do a lot. I couldn't tell you the last time I've seen them do that song. Maybe, I don't think I've seen them do it since we've been going to M3. I don't think that's been in any of the set lists at M3. I could be wrong, but that's my introduction to Kix. Seeing them live, Atomic Bombs, first song. Like I said, I couldn't tell you the set list. I could, you know, different songs here and there. I know they did Yeah, Yeah, Yeah. I know they did Cool Kids. I believe they even did Locomotion, which I hate. And we talked about the sax. But that's more weird for Kix for me than Cold Chills is. That's more like off the fucking radar for me. Next song, I can't believe no one picked this one.
Sex.
I knew you were gonna pick it.
Ooh, fucking fantastic. When they do it live, Steve brings out the fucking umbrella. Great song. The solo's good in it. The lyrics are fantastic. Just fucking great song. Next song, Cold Blood. Cold Blood is all you need. That's a song I don't know, I can't get enough of. I love the fucking live version on Kix Live in Baltimore. I talked about it a couple weeks ago as the crowd going back and forth. And you know I hate that shit. That shit just drives me fucking crazy. I came there to watch the band sing, not to hear me fucking sing. But I love when he puts the mic to the guy. But Cold Blood is all you need. That's bad. That's really, really bad. So that just cracks me up. That thing alone just fucking makes me fucking laugh every time I think of that. And actually listen to that. And I actually rewound it today when I was listening to it. So I could hear it right in a row. Girl Money, love that song. That's a song that me and BC always bust ass about. Some acquaintance we know we used to call the girl. And we always say his name when that song comes on. But it's just a great song, though. It really is. It's fucking just a straight-up rocker. Great song. And I like, too, because like BB kind of touched on it before, like the progression of these guys. First album, there's some like mellower, like cleaner guitars on it. Cool Kids a little more. But like Cool Kids was a little more poppy. But then like Midnight Dynamite was probably like way more polished than the first two albums, but more rock than the first two albums, I think. And cause that's when they had Bo Hill as their producer for that. And then you could pretty much call Blow My Fuse Midnight Dynamite 2. Because that progression, I think they're right in the same pocket there. But then Hotwire, is that album fucking rocks. That album just fucking kicks ass. Show Business. Any thoughts? I cannot find my copy of that album in the last probably 10 years, so I feel bad that I can't, because it's not on any streaming or anything. It's I didn't even think to look for it on YouTube, but I remember we saw them at Penn's Peak. They did Fireballs from there, from that album, and it was pretty cool, but it was like, it was weird because like I hadn't heard that song in forever, and it's pretty much an ignored album by those guys, but I gotta go with Girl Money. Like Hotwire is just a fucking fantastic album. Next song, I'm going to cheat on this one because I cannot separate these two songs, Poison and the Itch.
Only an hour in, and we have our cheating.
See, there you go. But I'll tell you why. And I don't know, I know I've told these guys, I don't know if I've told them on the podcast before. In the spring of 1984, we went to see Van Halen at the Spectrum in Philadelphia on a bus trip. And I don't think there was anybody on the bus that was over 21. And there was so much beer and Jack Daniels and fucking pot on that fucking bus. It was insane. There was a, you know, the not the little bottle of Jack Daniels, the big bottle, right? Jack. That was getting passed up and down the aisles, right? Saw the show. Autograph opened up for them. Show was fantastic. You know, after all these years, still a top three show for me. And then on the way home, all this crazy shit happened where the state police had tractor trailers block our bus in. All this crazy shit happened. Two guys got arrested because of the shit that went on at the fucking rest stop. And but after that, there was one boombox that still had battery life in it on the way back, and they played Poison and the Itch for an hour and a half straight. Just those two fucking songs. And it's like, fucking scratch the fucking itch and take the fucking poison. But they're in my fucking DNA now. Like, I cannot separate them two songs. And they're good. I really like them songs. They're fucking fantastic. But and I can't separate them two. So that's why. Sorry, Dylan. I had to throw something in there somewhere. And I'm going to go next with Mighty Mouth from Cool Kids. One of the more rocking songs on that album. I love that part of that song. Check that one out, BB.
I thought that's off Highwire.
No.
Or Hotwire.
No.
I had it originally on my list, and I didn't put it on my list just for that part. I'm like, it's a rocking song, but then that chorus part is just so stupid.
I love that part. Shut the fuck up, BB. It's my song. Let's fight. Your Penn State shirt off. God, I don't want to get blood on it. And then I go to the first album, The Kid. You start out with the little guitar solo in the beginning. I love how the drums kick in that. Great song. That was one of the songs that I remember them doing the first time that I saw them. Then I also shoot to the Midnight Dynamite album again for Red Hot Black and Blue. Red. I love the fucking chorus in that song. Just such a great, memorable track. That chorus is just burned in my brain. And back to the Hotwire album for me. Rock and Roll Overdose. Rock and Roll Overdose. Just, I listened to that today, and like I said, I hadn't listened to Hotwire in a long time, and that was one of the songs that as soon as it got done, boom, I had to put it right back on again. Just a straight-up kick-ass fucking rocker. And then back to the Blow My Fuse album for the last song, Get It While It's Hot. I love that. I love how Kix does a chorus like, get it while it's hot, and then you get the harmony, I'm on fire. I love how they do that on songs, and this is one that sticks out for me. The solo's really good in it. It's got a back and forth solo on it. Just a really great song. And I would when we saw them at M3, and they did this when they did the whole Blow My Fuse album, this is the one song I was like, fucking yeah. I want to say this is the song that I got the fucking drumstick from. Fucking Jimmy, fucking one hopper, fucking bing. Boom, and pff, fucking snagged it. We were like maybe second row, maybe second or third row. And I don't think anybody around me even saw it because he was looking, and I'm like, yeah, and he's like, and he did a one shot. He threw it flat, and it just fucking hit, and I just caught it with my left hand, just fucking snagged it out of the air. I was like, fucking yeah. Still have it at the house. Fucking absolutely love it. But just a fantastic band. If you guys are not familiar with Kix, number one, I don't know where you've been. And I just wanted to use this format as an excuse just to talk about Kix and just have an episode. Because we've talked about them here and there, about seeing them and stuff like that. But on September 14th, 1985, were you at the show Rocky Glen, BC? Really? Midnight Dynamite had just come out recently. And came out in October. Actually, it wasn't even out, now that I look at it. They played Rocky Glen Park, which used to be an amusement park near us in Moosic, Pennsylvania. It was there since, I think, the 50s maybe. And it just kind of got run down after, like, early 90s, I think, it was open until. And actually, now that I look at the dates, Midnight Dynamite was not even out when they played this show. but it was a small. It wasn't even a theater, just a one floor. I mean, that's where we saw Keel and okay. Quiet Riot and stuff and Cinderella. All these other bands. But they headlined it, and it was like local, like Harpo played there, Great Rock Scare played, and then there was like two other bands. The show started like 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and Kix came on, and they headlined this place, and the drum kit was a huge, like Peterbilt truck, the front of a truck, and it had the fucking smokestacks in there. When they did Lion Rubber, the smoke was coming out of the smokestacks, and that was when Steve Whiteman was allowed to come out with the Dynamite stick microphone with the fuse lit, open up the show with Midnight Dynamite, the fuse. That was a long fuse. That stayed lit for almost the whole fucking song. But that's my Kix show. Like I've seen the same show that you saw with Ace, which was fantastic when Cool Kids was out. And I saw them with Ace, and then I saw them with Quiet Riot before that. But this was my show. This was fantastic. The only thing that... that's a different show I'm thinking. I'm sorry. But just headlining that place was fantastic, because I think like right before that, we saw Ted Nugent there. Like Ted and Sabotage played. Were you at that show?
Yeah.
Okay. That might have been... That was 86. But... Rocky Glen was a great place to see a show, but like that was my Kix show, because it was like they headlined, because I had only seen them open for Ace, I seen them open for Quiet Riot at that point, and maybe because I think they were on a couple tours where, because they if a band played in Binghamton, they were the opening band, like Great White, you know, Britney Fox, bands like they were always on the bill, they were always that other band on the bill. So I had probably seen them maybe 4 times by then, but like that show at Rocky Glen, it was the first time that they actually had any stage props at all. They had this big like Mack truck. It was cool as fuck. And like if you could go back in time, I would just go back in time for these shows with my fucking iPhone and take fucking pictures of this shit. Because, I mean, you know, that was back in the days. Like, you know, if you took a camera, you had a 110 camera stuffed down your fucking pants in the picture. You literally had to be like 3 rows back to get a decent picture of any bands. Because I saw some pictures recently that Rob has when we saw Iron Maiden in Allentown in 1983. And like it's like the 110 camera, like 400 speed or something like that, filming it, you know? I would love to just go back. And the thing that sucks is, too, that when you go on Setlist FM, I'm glad the dates are there, but like most of these shows don't have any set lists on there. They just have pretty much the date that they played. So I would love to know everything, because I remember, because, you know, they had said their new album's coming out, was going to be like a month away, but they were doing shows, and it was fantastic. So guys out there, let us know what your Kix songs are. You a Kix fan? Are you not familiar with Kix, which can be totally totally understandable. But
we've only seen them 40 times.
I know. I think they're on the Monsters of Rock cruise this year too. Are they? Are they on there? I think they are. But like, you know, Steve Whiteman's going around the ship, and like the one year he's like, hey, just don't call me by my name. Just say, hey, fucker, when you see me. You walk by him, hey, fucker, hey, fucker, and just hey, see ya. You know, you just walk by, and it's like these guys, fuck you. No, fuck you. All right, see you later. So there's our list for Kix. Dylan is not totally familiar with the catalog, so that's why he just hanging out with us tonight. But
I know the hits. I know
he knows the hits. He knows
the hits. Play the hits.
I've seen them like 6 times.
Yeah. So what's your impression of them live, Dylan?
They have a really good energy, and they really know how to play to the crowd. Like they're very much in symphony with the crowd. Like where they are able to feed off the energy, and then the crowd is able to, you know, it's like a nice symbiotic relationship that I really think some bands struggle with. Like they don't connect with the crowd like they should, but Kix is not one of those bands. They know how to get in with the crowd and how to just get them pumped up. Like you could go in not knowing a single Kix song, but you'll come out having a good time. And that's a very rare thing to do, because a lot of times you'll listen to a band and you'll kind of be put off when you don't know their songs, and they're kind of expecting you to sing along, and you're a little like not sure about it, so that kind of throws you off. But with Kix, you never get that situation. It just, you feel like you're just having one big party.
That's except for that guy.
Yeah, except for the one guy, you know. But
He was having a good time. He just couldn't sing.
Yeah.
I can't sing either.
And it was a playful ribbing. He wasn't roasted the guy.
Yeah, he's like, oh, this guy fucking sucks.
They're a good party band. They're a good time band.
All right, so there's our Kix starter kit for you guys out there. Check out the songs. They will be on our Spotify playlist that will be in the show notes, so definitely check them out. If you want a great band to crack a beverage to, which we have been doing all night here, so check them out, and we'll go around the table. We'll get our final thoughts, and we will wrap up. Joe, thanks for coming. What do you got for us at the end here?
First of all, thanks for having me. I'd love to do this again someday, seriously. I want to give a shout-out to the official Kix fans page on Facebook. There's 15,000-plus members on that fan page.
Well, make sure you share the episode with them.
I definitely will. Also, you know, Jimmy Chalfont, he just had some health issues. So a shout-out to Jimmy. Hope you're feeling better. And Will Hunt from Evanescence and John Allen from Stone Horses have been filling in for Jimmy. And also Ronnie. You know, Ronnie's been going through his battles, mm-hmm. and it's definitely public. But I've heard from Ronnie. He texted me not that long ago. He's doing really well. He's doing everything he needs to do to get well. And good. A shout out to Bob Perry. You know, Bob Perry stepped right in. Bob Perry is a member of Everrise and Sundogs. If you're into Rush, you got to see Sundogs, because these guys, you close your eyes, you think.
I've seen a couple of videos from them.
Yeah, you think you're listening. You think you're seeing Rush live. And Bob plays an amazing Alex Lifeson part, and he's doing a phenomenal job. You know, filling in for Ronnie. Also, shout out to Steve Whiteman with his album, You're Welcome. I know it's going to come out in vinyl pretty soon.
Oh, good.
And I'm not sure this is going to happen, but I think, you know, right after Christmas, I think Brian's going out with Rhino Bucket for a little while, and maybe Steve will do some You're Welcome shows. And that would be pretty cool.
That'd be cool.
Cool if he did. But, you know, Kix is my band. I'm a vanilla ice cream kind of guy, I always say. You know, I hop on these bands. I was a Kiss fan. I was a Rush fan. Now, you know, we obviously know, like, after R40, Rush was done, and God rest Neil Peart's soul. And, you know, Kix is my band. They are my band. I love the guys, love the fans, love the shows. And you guys have said it a number of times here. They are by far the best live band. Mm-hmm. No ifs, ands, or buts.
There, you will not come away thinking, oh, they sucked.
So, thank you again for having me. I really, really appreciate it. It was an awesome night.
No problem. BB.
Yeah, definitely, Joe. Thanks for coming on. You know, I'm glad you have that little Kix family that, you know, you can share this episode with. I'm sure everybody will love this episode. And you guys already kind of hit it. These guys live are just fan-fucking-tastic. And even the songs that they bring are even like a step quicker. So like if it's a little little slower on like Cool Kids, like it's a little bit slower on the album. Live, it's punchy right in the throat. Fantastic stuff. Great live band, you know, and probably everybody here at the table, and we've seen them more than stinking 50 times added up all together. But a great episode. They don't get enough love. You know, they're always the supporting band and hardly ever the headliner. But great, great stuff out there. If you like guitars and harmonica, check these guys out.
All right. Any famous last words, Dylan? Or are you going to use what you...
Yeah, that's they're okay. Great. They're okay. A great band.
I don't know if you had anything. I didn't know if you had anything else you wanted to bring up.
No, they're fantastic. Thanks for coming on. It was awesome having somebody who's actually played with the band we're talking about. I mean, that's a very rare thing for us to have on the podcast. So it was very cool to have that experience for sure.
All right. Coolness. BC.
Joe, thanks for coming on. It's cool to have you. I remember going to a Rush show with you.
Yeah.
It was the very first show that they had seats way back in the day when they started doing reserve seating. The world's gone to shit.
Downfall of rock concerts.
Kix, I mean, my God, how many we've seen them easily.
Ballpark, how many times do you think we've seen them?
At least 35, 40. Throughout all the years?
I was going to say probably 50. Pretty close.
Figure what? How many M3s? 10?
10 M3s.
There's 10 times there.
And they open for everybody. And
everybody throughout Penn's the year.
Especially around here, times. You know, being from Baltimore, you know, yeah. Only for being 2 hours, 3 hours
like we've talked about
away.
It with Sonny, Kix is the East Coast version of Y&T.
Yeah, sure.
Everyone's seen them 100 times out there. We've seen them maybe 2 or 3 times. And we've seen Kix 1,000 times out here, and they've seen them once or twice out there.
Exactly. But, I mean, and unfortunately, other than M3, you never saw them headline. They've always been in a support act. And they come out, like you said, they don't care if they're a support act or not. They put on one hell of a show. Phenomenal with live band. If you leave a Kix show going, they're all right. You weren't at the show. Yeah. They're just phenomenal band that has stood the test of time. What, 70? Well, I guess say 81.
81.
81.
First album. Yep.
To now. And they're still going.
Yep. And I think, too, them taking that break did a lot of good for them. They all got a kind of chance to, I mean, and the music scene changed then, too. The music scene changed in the 90s. But, like, when they went out and they did Hotwire, like, that was, like, their most rock, you know, their hardest rocking album. And it's tough for me to speak to show business because I that was an album, too. It came out, what, 95. And there was still quite a bit of stuff out there, bands and stuff. So they were kind of Kix. Really, after Hotwire, they kind of went off the radar. That like, four-year period from 91 to 95 was a tough road for R-type bands. And I think they kind of got lost in the shuffle there, too. I remember when that came out, I bought the CD. Mm-hmm. But I didn't see them on that tour. I don't think I don't remember seeing them play on that tour at all. And, like, we had seen them play on all the other tours multiple times. But, like, when Show Business came out, I don't know how much quicker after that they, you know, because that was the last thing they did up until 2012. So that's a lot of time to be on the shelf. But you had Funny Money in between then. You had Rhino Bucket with Brian and stuff. But I'm glad they got that, you know, out of their system. But then they got back. So when they came back, it was like, I remember BC and I were talking about it. Holy shit, Kix coming back. Live album. They recorded a live album. We watched the DVD, checked out the album, absolutely loved it. Great song selection from there. And I was surprised, too, that I don't think they released it as a single, which I was surprised they didn't. I know Don't Close Your Eyes did really, really well for them and from the Blow My Fuse album. But I'm surprised that at that time, Midnight Dynamite came out in 85. That was when you had... You know, Whitesnake 84 was already out, and you were hitting the power ballads like crazy. But, like, Walking Away is a really good ballad from Midnight Dynamite. It's kind of forgotten about, and I'm pretty sure they played that live when we saw them. But, like, Steve Whiteman can do that softer stuff. Like, Don't Close Your Eyes. That's the lighters come out for that song. The lighters fucking come out for that song. And that's a real... I wanted to, you know, not do the show and not talk about that song. Because that song was big for them. That was the song that got them
that's why we're
over
here.
To the West Coast, I think. Because that they had the video for it. And I don't really remember any other... A lot of videos from Kix other than that.
Yeah.
Well, the Cool Kids video. Cool Kids had, there was a video for Cool
yeah,
Kids.
But I mean, that you've seen like a lot. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like yeah. They really didn't have anything besides that in heavy rotation.
Well, right. You're right. And then, you know, Steve tells the story on stage about Don't Close Your Eyes, where that was on the B-side.
Yeah.
You know, and whoever it was, whatever.
Thank God for those guys that flipped this shit over.
Well, right. No, but whatever person it was and said, you know, here's your hit.
Yeah.
You know, play.
And you got to think, too, like, especially in that time, like, how did the record company not say, holy shit, that's the one? You know what I mean? I know most bands, you want to put a rocker out there first for the rock, but then you bring that ballad in second, you got the guys, now you got to get the girls in.
Yeah.
Yep.
You know? So I just wanted to make sure I brought up that song because that song was huge for those guys.
Even the Tear Down the Walls from Hotwire is another, you know, ballady, slower, which is a good song in that category.
Yeah. But like, I just wanted to bring up Walking Away too because I thought that came on and I'm like, wow, I haven't really heard this one in a long time. It's another really good song. So
the only other ballad they pop in the set list now is For Shame. Once in a while they pop in for shame.
I know. Right. They busted that out at M3 once or twice.
Yeah. That's a shame.
And I'm like, oh, there's my piss song. There's, sorry.
That's a shame.
I just can't stand that song. It's just it's too whiny for me. It's too whiny for me.
But Don't Close Your Eyes, you go back to Don't Close Your Eyes, it's in every single set list.
Yeah. Oh yeah. That's the one that people want
to play
hear.
The hit.
Yeah.
Planets.
So yeah, so guys, check out some Kix. You want to have a party on a Friday night, Saturday night, whatever, throw a Kix playlist in there or throw a playlist on there, throw a couple Kix songs in there. And if people aren't familiar with them, people will go, holy shit, who's this? This is a great song. You play it at whatever party. So that may also get, you know, someone into the band and might make them want to check out more. So great party band. I couldn't tell you the amount of damage to my liver that this band has done over the years, tonight included. So, Joe, once again, thanks for coming on. It was awesome having you on. We'll definitely get you back on here again. And good to have the band back together again tonight. And we'll be back next week. Go ahead.
No, I was.
Oh, I thought you were gonna say something. Okay.
No, thumbs up.
Yeah. So great to have everybody back here in the same room again. And thank you guys out there for listening, for sharing our stuff, for interacting with us. We love you guys. It's fantastic. I can't believe the amount of listeners we have. The countries, like I look at our stats and the countries that we have listeners in is fucking insane. I'm like, there's a couple countries I never even heard of that come up on our thing that I'm like is that
Canada?
I'm like, yeah. Next ISO. But literally there's a couple countries I'm like, wow, is that even like a fucking country? But it is, and we appreciate every single one of you guys. And share us with your friends out there, and you know, check us out. Check out our back episodes. If you're a new listener, welcome. If you're an old listener, you know, welcome back. And you know, go back and check out our older episodes. We cover a ton of stuff. We have a ton of stuff coming up, and I probably have my fellow co-hosts insane here with the rigorous schedule that I foist upon them. And shit we listen to, but it's a labor of love. We love doing it. If we didn't, we would say, fuck it, that's it. So you guys, thanks out there. We really appreciate you guys. Take care of yourselves and each other, and we will see you next time, and there definitely will be a next time.